Okay, I am so ready. I am ready to get started. I know I usually let the video play all the way to the end. It is so good to see you. If you can, go ahead and turn on your cameras so that I can see your beautiful face. My loves, my loves, my loves. Powerhouses are in the building. Yes, you are. If this is your first time with us, go ahead and put a one in the chat. If this is your second time with us, go ahead and slap a two in the chat and write, "I'm back," or just put a two. And if we're stuck with you because you are family and you're always here and you're like, "Queen, pass the mic to me so that I can start running this show," put family in the chat. I want to see who we got. Put on my glasses here so that I can see. Hey, listen, if you are a life coach, if you're a content creator, if you are an author, if you are a speaker, and you know that God comes first and you know that God drives your business, and you want to learn more secrets to how to get visibility on your business. You want to learn how you can connect with people who are just like you on this journey, then you are in the right spot. We're going to start off with some scripture, and then afterwards, then I'm going to beam you up into your breakthrough sessions. So if you haven't done so already, go ahead and grab your social media handles, go ahead and grab your scheduling links, because I am going to send you in a breakthrough room after we talk about God, because we always want to put God first, so that you can network and find out, like, wow, how does this person fit into my vision for the future? All right, let me check the chat real quick, right fast. Terry, it is your first time. Welcome, 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 Terry, in the house without a doubt. We got Tamia, Taylor, hey, Sandra, hey, Heidi, Christine, yes, Terry again, yes. Do we have two Terrys, or is that the, let me see. Okay, no, it's Terry. It's same Terry. All right, Dr. Seegers, my love. Yes. And I predict we're gonna have some more folks joining us as the hour progresses. Hey, listen, let me ask you, because it seems to me that in my life, like the same people will call me and they have the same problems. Like they treat me like I am their answering machine, like I have all the answers, right? Anybody else experience that? Like there's these one or two people that always call you like, "I'm broke," or I can't figure out how to balance work and school, or this relationship is just draining me, or what? Anybody else been there? Let me encourage you right now. I want to say this and hear me, loves. Let me encourage you. Stop trying to fix their problems the old way. And this is what I mean by that. If God ain't in it is not going to get fixed. When we give these people this great advice on how they can budget and how they can create healthier relationships and how they can build and launch their own business, it's great advice. But if they are not attached to something that's bigger and greater than who they are, it is not going to stick. So I'm going to open up scripture and I'm going to give you an example of what this looked like. I'm going to bring it all home. And the beautiful thing about this is because we already went over part one of how to write a sermon, I want you to see the analogies, the theology behind the text I'm going to show you, because you're going to need that for part two. So I'm going to talk for about 10 minutes, part two, on how to write a scripture. All right, so let me go here to my to King James here. And oh yes. So to kick this off, baby, this is where we're gonna start. We're gonna start off with 2 Kings. Those of you that know me, you know that I am a fan of Bible Gateway. I have no affiliation with them, but anytime you need to get the scripture quickly, and if you need to look at all the different versions, as you can see here. Absolutely. I recommend Bible Gateway. It's pretty cool. All right. So let's go ahead and dive into it. I'm going to be reading from 2 Kings. I'm going to go to chapter 4, and I'm going to stop here around verse 7. Elijah and the widow's oil. Anybody heard this yet? Anybody read it? Okay. This right here, this is the gift that keeps on giving. Now, the wife of one of the sons of the prophets cried to Elijah, "Your servant, my husband, is dead. And you know that your servant feared the Lord. So her husband loved God, but the creditor has come to take my two children to be his slaves. He loved God, but he wasn't paying his bills. And it's not like how it is for you and I today. If we don't pay our bills, it may go on our credit report. They may come and repossess or foreclose something, but they don't come take your children. Because if they did, most of us would probably have no kids, wouldn't you agree? So when you talk about stress, I want you to look at this and look at it from this wife's perspective, and also as though you are an eyewitness on the ground. What must it have been like for this woman? She just lost her husband. She's grieving over her husband. And now they are about to come take her kids and make them slaves. Not just take them, but take them not so they can go to a better home like how they do it today. Today they will come, take the kids, probably put them in some type of adoption program. But to back then, and make them slaves. That's stress. And Elijah said to her, "What shall I do for you? Tell me, what have you in the house?" So he didn't say, Elijah didn't say, "How much you owe? Let me write you a check. Or let me call those creditors for you." I want you to notice how Elijah gave her a strategy, right? He already knows that God is in this house, but he goes on to give her a strategy. I want you guys to listen, pay attention here, because when folks come to you and they say, I need, the part of the reason why they keep coming to you saying, I need, because you are their Jesus. You're not letting Jesus take the wheel. You're not giving them an opportunity to exercise their faith and get to know Jesus, because you're fixing it all for them. I want you to keep that in mind, you mothers with these sons that are still depending on you to pay your bills and pay their bills. All right? Elijah is about to give her a strategy. Okay, so Elijah said to her, verse 2, and Elijah said to her, "What shall I do for you? Tell me, what have you in the house?" And she said, "Your servant has nothing in the house." That's how some of you guys are. When you say, "I want a business, but I just don't know what I can do. There's nothing I can do. I have no purpose. I have no skills. I have no leadership experience. I have nothing." She says, "Your servant has nothing in the house except a jar of oil." That's all I have, a jar of oil. See, whatever it is that you powerhouses are called to do, God has already planted this natural affinity for it inside of you. But the problem is you're overlooking it, because you think that in order to be successful, in order to help the world, I got to start off with $1 million and 9,000 businesses and buildings and things like that. No, you guys hear me say it all the time. People need solutions to everyday problems. They don't need your rocket science. They don't. That's why I'm consistently niching you down so that you can figure out small problems that you can fix for people. There's a lady who comes to my house every other week and cleans my house from top to bottom. She solves a real problem for me. Because one, I'm not gonna clean. I'm in seminary school. I got businesses. I'm big in the church. I'm a single mother. I got all this stuff. I'm just not gonna clean. And second of all, I'm just not good at it. And I don't feel guilty about not cleaning. And so there are people out there who will solve that incredibly niche problem for me. Organize my closet, put all the colors together, and good at it. And she gets paid very well. Got a waiting list. Feeding her family, creating first generational wealth, solving problems. Okay, let me get back to the scripture. So she says, "Your servant has nothing in the house except a jar of oil." I want you to start looking for your jar of oil, whatever that is for you. Then he said, "Go outside, borrow vessels from all your neighbors, empty vessels and not too few." Go outside and borrow vessels from all of your neighbors. Go outside and put some visibility on what it is that you need. See, some of you won't even post on social media because I sit here and I think about this wife, and back then, because they didn't have social media, they didn't have television, so everybody was in everybody's business. I bet you everybody knew that her husband had died. I bet you everybody knew that she was in debt. And I bet you it probably really disturbed her to have to say, hey, can I go and borrow some vessels? Knowing that these people probably are like, man, look, her husband don't left her. He died, left her in debt. They about to come take her sons. You know how people gossip. But she had to say, you know what? I'm going to go ahead. I'm going to risk it all. I'm going to risk it all. And I'm going to go and I'm going to ask my neighbors for their empty vessels. And not too few. I'm going to go over to verse 4. Then go in and shut the door behind yourself and your sons, and pour into all these vessels. So once you identify what you got, this seed that God has already put inside of you, once you identify what you got, go out and find out who can help you with this. That's a big part of the reason why I'm gonna send you into your networking group in a second. Go out and borrow vessels. And then after that, I need you to go and sit in silence, cut off that TV, cut off that social media, stop hanging out in the streets. I need you to go shut the door behind yourselves and get your sons. Find out who you can delegate to. Find out who your partners are, who will be with you through thick and thin, who will help you with this. It won't be everybody, but it will be somebody. Shut the door and then pour into all of these different vessels. Some of you need to pour into your social media campaigns. Some of you need to pour into your business bank accounts. What do you need to pour into? And then when one is full, set it aside. So she went from him and she shut the door behind herself and her sons. And as she poured, they brought the vessels to her. So she didn't try to do everything on her own. No. See, some of y'all, like, if it's got to be done right, I got to do it myself. So I'm going to do everything on my own. Most of you that are in the Powerhouse program, you know my philosophy. If it's been on your plate for longer than 10 days, if it's been on your to-do list for longer than 10 days, it doesn't belong to you. You got to go find the who. Who do I need to contact to help me with this? So her sons brought her the vessels. And when the vessels were full, she said to her son, bring me another vessel. And he said to her, finally, there is not another. Then the oil stopped flowing. Wait a minute. You mean to tell me she had so much seed, so much oil, that she was able to fill all of the vessels? She came and told the man of God, and he said, go, sell the oil and pay your debts, and you and your sons can live on the rest. That is amazing. Praise God. Go sell, pay your debts, and you and your sons can live on the rest. What? Off this little jar of oil, we can go and live on the rest. We can create first generational wealth. Get out of here. Get out of here. So what I'm hoping that you get from this, loves, is that when you are helping the people who you're called to help, it begins with God. It begins with God. And I'm going to tell you why. Because if they are not fixed to something bigger than themselves, if the people stop coming and the money stop flowing and their health fails just a little bit, they're going to collapse. They're going to give up. They're going to throw in the towel. But when you know that you can do all things through Christ that strengthens you, you won't stop. Another thing that I'm hoping that you might get from this is that a lot of you, when you launch your businesses, you're going to find that people will continue to die. People will continue to get sick. The doctor may even give you a diagnosis. Bills will still roll in. the feces will continue to hit the fan. And it breaks my heart, but when a lot of powerhouses encounter this, they throw in the towel. They say it just wasn't meant to be. I want to offer you a reframe on that. I want to say to you that when the feces hits the fan, when your loved ones are in the hospital and you get these calls that somebody has transitioned, or when the doctor says, hey, I need to run some additional tests, when your car stops running, when these things happen to you, I need for you to forge ahead. Because that means that you are a threat to something. You are a threat. Something is trying to knock you off your course. When I sit and I think about Pharaoh and how he sent out a decree that he wanted all the Hebrew boys murdered. Hebrew baby boys. What? How can a Hebrew baby boy threaten a Pharaoh? A Pharaoh. Clearly that Pharaoh saw something in those baby boys that their mothers probably didn't even see in them. That they couldn't even walk yet or talk yet. But the Pharaoh was like, wipe them out, because one day they're going to grow up and they're going to rise up against me. When I think about David and Goliath, the enemy sent a giant to kill a boy. A boy. Of course, later on, he went on to become king. But that enemy clearly saw something in that boy that he had not yet even identified in himself. So when you go outside and your car has been running all week, but it's time for you to go to that important meeting, it's time for you to do something on behalf of your vision, and that car starts to stall, I need for you powerhouses to start rejoicing. Oh, nothing ticks the enemy off more. I don't care if you don't have the money. You might say, you know, my car is broke. I don't have money to fix it. It's always the alternator. Why can't it just be a $250 battery? Why has it got to be a whole alternator? I don't have the money for that. I don't have the thousands of dollars that I believe I need to launch my business. I don't have it. The bank just denied me. They said my credit score was too low. I'm here to tell you that when I launched my first business, I launched my business. I got approved. I got a truck and some other brand new truck off the lot and some other things. My credit score was like a 550. 550 when I did that. And I just went and still applied like everything was okay. My loves, when these things happen, I need for you to just rejoice. You may not have the resources, but you still got your joy when I sit and think about the Apostle Paul in Philippians, sitting in that prison, writing letters to the church of Philippi, telling them to rejoice. He in prison. How is it that you are in prison and you're motivating people that's free? You're in a Roman prison. Do you know what that was like? To be in a dark, cold, damp cell next to people who are probably screaming down the hall, poor air circulation. You're barely fed. People walking around like skeletons, treating you like crap. But you're writing letters. Rejoice. They couldn't take his joy. So, my loves, my point is that when the enemy comes at you like that, I need for you to say, oh my goodness, I must be onto the right path, because he is trying to throw me off. And it must be for a reason, because clearly, my loves, the enemy sees something in you that you haven't even quite identified in yourself. So I say congratulations. Oh, congratulations, my loves. So if, and now I want to transition into writing a sermon. If I were to write a sermon on the scripture that we just read, I might say the theological idea of it all, one of the theological ideas that I could possibly bring to surface, is that God provides in time of desperation. He's already giving you what you needed. That's a theological idea. So when you're writing your sermon, what I want you to remember is that when you are preaching, it's not about, or when you're Bible study, whatever you're called to do, it's not about you pointing out problems. Like, y'all need to pay tithes. Y'all need to stop smoking. Y'all need to start coming to church on time. That's not a theological idea. The Bible was written, hold on now. I'm gonna tell you. The Bible was written for one reason. I don't care what anybody tells you. It was written for one reason, and that is to reveal God. The Bible was written to reveal God. But it's just amazing that we're able to get all of this other greatness from it. But the reason is to reveal God. Why are you saying that, Coach Queen? I'm telling you this because when you are extracting from scripture, the first question I need for you to ask is, what does this reveal about God? Otherwise, you will go and you will share a sermon or a message about changing behavior. And that's absolutely fine if it's in your sermon points. But the overarching goal is to make sure that your audience walks away understanding what the passage is revealing about God. Because if you use the Bible to just change behavior, to say that's why you should be on time to church, that's why you should dress a certain way, you are not going to change behavior. The only way to help people is to show them how they can increase their faith, their trust in God. That's it. That is the bonding glue that holds everything together. If you trust in God, everything else will fall into place. If you have faith in God, everything else, it will fall in place. So when you are writing your sermon, I need for you to identify the theological idea, which is, what does this message reveal about God? Does it reveal how powerful he is or how compassionate he is? Maybe it reveals something about salvation or the commandments, but it is up to you to extract that. And one of the ways that you can extract that is based on, remember in part one, if you haven't seen part one, it's on YouTube. And I'll be sure to drop the link in the chat to the replay for part one, where I had you guys go in and extract all of the verbs and the subjects and the modifiers. You remember that? Once you do that, you're going to be able to form what's called division points or sermon points, division statements or sermon points. Let me share my screen here because I want to show you something. Make this easier because I can't wait for you guys to get into your breakout rooms and start networking with one another. Let's see. All right. Oh, let's move all this stuff off the screen. Move you. And let's move you out the way too. Okay, I think we're in business. Okay, so we are ready. So we already shared some scripture that backs up why we should go out and preach. Even if you're not called to the pulpit, I want to remind you of the Great Commission. If you look over at Matthew 28, 19, 20 here, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. So for those of you that are crossed about being a woman and going out and sharing the message, I need for you to look at this verse right here and tell me where it says only men go out and share the message. Only young boys. Now you don't see that. Go for. All right. And then also go over here and look at Galatians. Go and give that a visit. Feel free to screenshot anything you see here. And if I am speaking too fast, keep in mind that the video replay will be available to you on YouTube. Usually it takes me about 24 hours to get the replays posted. All right. So take solace in that. All right. Here are some of the resources for writing a sermon. I highly recommend that if you are someone that's disciplined and structured, that you get the 12 essential skills for great preaching. That's one of the books in seminary school that we had to read. It's very detailed and it will stretch you. And then also this one here, Preaching Killer Sermons. This one is free. All of them are great, but this one you can download. You can go to Amazon and you can download that one for free right now if you like. Preaching Killer Sermons. And then this one right here is as it relates to evangelizing. I love Share Jesus Without Fear, because if you know that you are called to evangelize, like you know you're called to share God's message, but you're not producing any fruit, please get this Share Jesus Without Fear. It gives you 5 basic questions that you can ask someone to help someone to reach their come to Christ moment. And it's so simple. It's, oh my goodness. I love making complex things simple. All right, so if you remember from part one, what we're doing is we're actually going through Luke 19, 1-10, all right? And we're talking about Jesus and Zacchaeus. Yes, yes, yes. Now I want you to keep in mind, we're not talking about Zechariah. Zechariah was a prophet. Zechariah is found in the book of Zechariah. Zechariah, he had visions for the future of Israel. That's someone else. We're talking about Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. And Zacchaeus is mainly remembered for repentance and transformation, if you remember. All right, so we're talking about Zacchaeus. And so if you see here in the scripture, Jesus is entering into Jericho and he's passing through. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector. So you see the word chief? Remember how I had you write out all the subjects in this passage, all the verbs, all the modifier? One modifier would be chief. He wasn't just a tax collector. He was a chief tax collector. It makes it more descriptive. That's what modifiers do. He was a chief tax collector and he was rich and he was seeking to see who Jesus was, but on the count of the crowd, he could not because he was small in stature. And if you remember, I recommend that before you step in front of your congregation or your audience, that you read your content at least 50 times and read different versions, because some version says that he was short in stature, that he was short. And if I were to, we're going into our natural analogies here. If I were to bring out a natural analogy. So a natural analogy is a way that you tap into your life experiences in order to bridge the text, the biblical scripture, in order to bridge the text to something that your audience can identify with. Because your audience may not know what it feels like to be short. They may have heard of things like Napoleon syndrome, and they may know somebody that's short, but a lot of your audience may not know what it feels like to be short. And so you will find that when you are unveiling your sermon, you'll find that you need to make your message, your scripture, you need to make it relevant to your audience today. All right. And the way that we do that is through natural analogies. So, for example, and I'm gonna give you an example in a second, another one. But for example, some people know what it's like to want to get somewhere, but they can't because there's a crowd blocking them. And then you can even take it to, oh my goodness, I want to do better, but society is saying, because I am a woman, I can't do this. I should stay at home and raise my kids and be a good housewife. Maybe tradition is the reason why this person can't see. So there's a way for you to bring it home. You may even say, okay, because he was short in nature, you may even spin that and say, I want you to think of some times that you came up short. And if I was going to use a natural analogy, I could talk about, and this is not the case for my house, but I've seen this in other houses. I might say, I might give an analogy about a family who has a cross in their living room, but there's no Christ in their cross. So maybe they go to church every Sunday, but when they come home, they're drinking, they're doing drugs, they're playing profane music, They're just doing anything. They got, you know, you got a woman or a man, and they got different lovers coming in and out of the house. But then yet they expect for their kids to grow up righteously and to do the right thing. And I may talk about an example of how people come up short and tie it into Zacchaeus being short. You see, that's a natural analogy. And usually the natural analogy comes from your life. So in a second, I'm going to give you guys an exercise, and you're going to take it home that you can use to bring out the natural analogies that's going to bridge this historical text to why it is meaningful to your audience today. You guys with me? Everybody good? Vibe check. Put a one in the check if you're still with me and you're good. Let's see. I want to just check on you for a second. All right. Thank you, Taylor. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Seegers. Thank you, Sandra. Thank you, Christine. All right. Wonderful. All right. I'm going to wrap this up in a second. Let me keep going. Thank you, Terry, again. All right. So he ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him. So as a part of your verb collection, you wrote down ran, you wrote down climbed. Then you should be asking all of those who, what, when, where, how questions, that format I gave you in part one. Like, if he's rich, why would he run? Why would he climb? And then he's short. Short people don't do things to make themselves look shorter. He's short and he's rich. But yet he's willing to run and climb and to sit there in the tree already short like a child with his legs dangling from the branch. So that's something for you to ponder on as well. So he ran ahead. He ran on ahead and climbed up into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was about to pass that way. Jesus was about to pass. He just did all that just to get a glimpse of Jesus. So he's a rich man. Rich people, it's usually assumed that rich people kind of got it all, but he's running and he's climbing and he's doing all these things that short people won't do because it hurts their pride normally. So clearly he's rich and clearly he don't have it all because he's seeking Jesus and he's willing to do all these things just to get a glimpse of Jesus. He doesn't have an appointment with him. Jesus is going to pass that way. That should make you think alone. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. I want you to remember what we talked about in part one. Jesus looked up at Zacchaeus and said his name. Can you imagine what it was like for you when you were down in the valley and you were running and you were seeking Jesus? Can you imagine what it might have felt like? And maybe you experienced it, for Jesus to look up and to say your name, Aaliyah, Bray, Christine, Diane, Dr. Mary, Heidi, Keita, Rebecca, Rava, Sandra. For Jesus to look up and say to you, hurry up and come down, for I'm about to stay at your place tonight. That would be the perfect place to bookmark how you might have felt, how Zacchaeus might have felt. Is your house ready? Is your house in order? Do you have any lovers you need to stash? Is your house clean? Do you have a sink piled with dishes? Or are you ready? Are you like, yes, come on in, Lord? Or do you say, no, God, not right now, like most of us did. Oh, God, not right now. I'm not ready to give up my old ways. I'm not ready for you to come into my house yet. Give me like a month. I got some cleaning to do. So bookmark that. But guess what Zacchaeus did? Zacchaeus, he hurried and he came down. He did it right. Wouldn't it be great if we answered, yes, Lord, come on the first time. But Zacchaeus, the first time, yes. Zacchaeus hurried and came down and received them joyfully. And when they saw it, they, the crowd, the people that don't want you to launch your business, the people who don't want you on stage, the people who don't want you to get better. When they saw it, they all grumbled. He has gone to be the guest of a man who is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said to the Lord, behold, Lord, there's a big silence in between verse 7 and verse 8. We talked about it in part one because something must have happened because Jesus went into the house. And then the next thing we get is Zacchaeus. He's standing up and saying to the Lord, behold, Lord, The half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I restore it fourfold. You should have some questions right there. Like, what happened? Clearly, Zacchaeus was saved and transformed. Well, what does it take to be saved and transformed? Clearly, that happened because now Zacchaeus is calling him Lord, which is a part of salvation. So we're at verse 9, and Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, since he is also a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save, seek and save, more verbs, the lost. So let's keep going, because I don't want you to, when you are designing your sermon, I don't want you to just get up and again, only preach the scripture. I need for you to bridge it to your audience's everyday life. And this is how you're going to do it. We talked about the sermon design already. We talked about sermon development. So you've already listed all your verbs from that passage of Luke 19. You've already identified all your verbs, right? And that's going to help you with your sermon points. Because some of you are like, well, how do I turn this into an impactful, influential message? And I also want to make sure I'm not misrepresenting God in the text and what he wants me to say. So you're going to look at this, and this is going to help you to create your sermon points. And then you're going to list all your modifiers, right? He wasn't just a tax collector. He was a chief tax collector. And then you're going to identify all your subjects, because you can easily go into these and you can create 3, 4, 5 sermon points just based off of the verbs, the modifiers, and the subject alone. And pray, of course. God, what do you want me to get from this? What do you want me to tell your people? All right. So now what is going to happen is, once you've gotten all of that together, you're going to start working on your natural analogies, which is going to be your homework powerhouses, your natural analogies. Yes. So you're going to look at family, for example. And when you look at family and based off of your subject, based off your modifiers and your verbs, you might say that, okay, one sermon point that I can make is that Jesus transforms the broken. That might be a sermon point. Of course, you'll jazz it up some, but just right off the dome, because I don't want to taint something great that God can give you. So I'll keep it basic like that. You might say that, you know, Jesus transforms the broken. That might be a sermon point, right? So when you do that, I want you to then look at all of these categories. Look at family, business, athletics. I want you to think about family and think about how Jesus can transform a broken family. And it should come from real life, not made up stories. It's way more powerful when you're talking about transformation in real life. So you see nature there. If I was going to use nature, and again, you're not going to overthink it. You're just going to write out just whatever comes to mind, a story, either about someone you know, yourself, children, education, it's one of these categories. It could be from the news, but it really helps if it's something real. And when you do that, you are going to just write a bulleted, like little notes. You're not going to write a whole article for each one. You may write 5 or 10 sentences. Just don't overthink it. Just write it down, and then you'll come back to it later. Because you're not going to use all of your natural analogies. You're going to pick out the one that fits best for what it is that you're trying to communicate. And chances are you will use a natural analogy for each and every last one of your points. Now let's pause for a second. For those of you that are like, well, I don't feel called to preach or to teach Bible study, but even when you're on stage, you're still going to need natural analogies. If you get on stage and you tell people, for example, that it's time to get over our past, we can't let our history make our destiny, you still need a natural analogy. You have to use words to affect the whole person. The left brain, the right brain, the heart, the mind, the soul, the spirit, the whole person. And natural analogies help to light their brains on fire. So you may talk about, for your sermon point with family or with nature, you may talk about, okay, Do you guys know what the process that a caterpillar goes through before it becomes a butterfly? And you may talk about how the body breaks down and it becomes like liquid. And then you may even talk about how after all of that painfulness happens, how it then its body turns inside out and then it hangs in this J from a tree branch. And then you may talk about how even as it's going through that transformation, the world doesn't stop. Raccoons will still come and try to feed on it. Insects, the winds will still blow. It won't stop and say, hey, this little caterpillar is trying to become its best, so we're gonna leave it alone. That's not how it happens, right? But this caterpillar has to trust the process. And even as it's going through this excruciating pain of trying to get the money to launch its business, of trying to find the right words to launch its message, or whatever it is for you or your audience, it's hanging there, trusting that as long as it puts its faith in Christ, that when it comes out of this chrysalis, this cocoon, this chrysalis, that God is going to brush its wings with the most beautiful paint. And you could talk about how transformation is that, like a butterfly, for example, or you can use a real life story, like about people. It's up to you and all. But nonetheless, you're going to go through every last one of these categories and you are going to write just whatever comes to mind. It's going to stretch you. I already told you in part one, this process will stretch you. Preaching, putting together a sermon, it takes a supernatural calling. It takes a lot of focus. And if you think for a second that you're just gonna step into these shoes and just in 10 minutes, I got it. And you go out and just, no. It doesn't work that way. It takes years and years of practice. Now, there are some people who are just like, God is like, hey, I'm gonna put this in you, bam. I have heard of that. But for most people, it is something that you have to work towards. So if you do feel a little stretched when you're going through the process, all I can say is welcome to the club. It does stretch you. That's just a part of the process. All right. So I want you, as your call to action, to go in and come up with a natural analogy for each one of these categories based off the sermon points that you have extracted from Luke 19. There's no wrong answer, no wrong answer whatsoever. If you were in the military, you can plug in your military experience and talk about transformation. You might, especially if you're talking to a military audience, that will really resonate with them to talk about how a private goes from being a private to a general and how they walk different than when they were a private. And by the time they are a general, how they are walking like this. So you very well could do that, my loves. All right, so I'm gonna stop here. Tell me, are there any questions? And I'm going to stop and look at the chat. Any questions? Any questions? If you have a question, raise your digital hand. If you go down below to the toolbar at the bottom, you'll see an option to raise hand. Raise your hand if you have a question. Any? Okay. All right. And so we're going to wrap this up. Where will the replay be? I came late. Oh, it's on YouTube. Usually I send out a you'll get it in your email that the replay is available and you can grab it from there. All right. Great question though. Great question, Aaliyah. So I am going to send you into your breakthrough rooms, my loves. You're welcome into your breakthrough rooms. This is an opportunity for you to network and to just meet somebody who might be a good fit. We've had folks that come on and say, hey, I met my business partner here and we're doing some joint ventures together. And it's just so amazing to hear. It's so good to see you, Rebecca. So glad you can make it, my love. So I'm gonna get the breakout rooms ready. And go ahead and grab your social media handles, your scheduling software, because you are highly encouraged to network when you are in those rooms. And while I am doing this, would somebody please unmute and share the one rule that we have here on this platform?
Never pass up the opportunity to take the mic.
Yes. Never, my loves, never pass up the opportunity to take the mic. It is so easy to do. I like that closed mouths don't get fed. Oh my goodness. Absolutely, Taylor. Taylor, I'm telling you, God can use anything, anything that is of you except your silence. Never pass up the opportunity to take the mic, my loves. And keep in mind that it's easy to do when you know that you're speaking to share, you're not speaking to impress. Most of you guys know my history. I am not a gifted speaker, but I am a courageous speaker. I will run over a word in a second because I used to have a speech impediment. And every once in a while, it tries to surface and I just have to smother that thing. And so I want you to know that God is ready to use you as you are now. Even Moses. Moses was like, no, God, I'm not an eloquent speaker. Not me, not me. Please don't choose me. And God had to remind Moses, who made you? Who made you? And then next thing you know, Moses was the vessel that God used to deliver the Israelites from bondage in Egypt. Beautiful. Oh my goodness. Next thing you know, Moses is writing the first five books of the Bible. Now you understand why the Pharaoh was trying to kill all the Hebrew boys. Isn't that something? Okay. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and rename these rules, these rooms, lessons I learned, so I can get y'all beamed up. And so while you are in the rooms, my loves, let me say that when you get in there, if you have questions about the topic, ask questions. Anybody know how to build a great social media campaign? Ask that question. But if you have something to pour into about the subject, then go in and say, hey, I just found this great tool, this great system about how to launch a marketing campaign. So you can take the topic based on any angle that you need. But please, please ask for help, my loves, if you need help. And if you have something to give, please give it. Asking for help is not a sign of weakness. Asking for help is a sign that you refuse to give up. So please don't be bashful when you're in there. Networking. Okay, I'm just gonna put networking and then okay, I think I got some good topics here. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and open up the rooms, my loves. In order to get into the room, the only thing you have to do is take your mouse and then just self-select the rooms. You can jump around from room to room. The rooms will be up in 20 minutes. Go ahead and start selecting. You may decide to go in a room and talk about being faithful to God and take it from any way you want to. You could talk about some lessons you learned in business. You may be able to save somebody some serious heartache by saying, hey, this is a lesson I learned. You can go in and talk about marketing. You can talk about networking. You can even talk about some books that you love, from the Bible to one of the books that I love by Viktor Frankl, Man's Search for a Meaning. You may want to do that. And if you need any assistance getting into any one of the rooms, only thing you have to do is unmute and say, Queen, put me in the faithfulness to God room, or put me in the lessons I learned room, or marketing room, or networking room, or books I love room. Or you can just type it in the chat. I'm looking out for both, and I got you either way. Nonetheless, take your time, select a room, but if you need help, either unmute and tell me which room you want to go in, or just type it in the chat. Wow, we got quite a few folks going in the faithfulness to God room. Look at that. Wow. Wow. Followed by the marketing like a pro room and the networking innovation room. Lots of faithfulness to God. Praise God. Praise God. I love that you guys are jumping in that room first. You're working on your faithfulness. You're sharing your faithfulness. It's just beautiful. Okay, how do we feel, powerhouses? You guys good? Okay, so I'm going to challenge you, please, 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 in your spare time, whenever you get a chance, please go and work on your natural analogies. Go ahead and bring them home. Start thinking about some life experiences. You know, you can live vicariously through others, or you could take a page from your own book, go through your journals, whatever you got to do. Start stacking them, because as you increase your toolbox, your treasure box of messages, of presentations, speeches, sermons, whatever it is, it just really helps to say, you know what, let me go back and visit my treasure box. Because when you are speaking, how many of you feel like, you know, I want to speak, but I'm afraid I'm gonna lose my place? Anybody? Or I want to speak, but I need to write everything word for word. And let me say to you that in the beginning, when you first start speaking, a lot of people do sing karaoke. A lot of the times in the beginning, we sing somebody else's song until we learn to write our own. There's nothing wrong with that process. There's nothing wrong with that. But eventually, you want to get away from that. And one of the best ways you can get away from that is to rely on stories. Because facts tell, but stories sell. And so for you to just step in and to tell a story that is of you, oh my goodness, you don't need a script from that. You're not boxed in. And everybody is able to get what they need from your story. It's just so amazing when that happens. So I'm gonna go ahead and get y'all out of here. We're getting out of here about 13 minutes early today. Go queen. Listen, as you go about your day, please, please, powerhouses, remember, never pass up the opportunity to take the mic. And as a matter of fact, I have dropped the link to the very first part one that we did a few weeks ago. It's in the chat. Let me see if I can find it. Let me scroll up some. Oh, good. You guys are dropping your contact information in there. Please save the chat if you can. Some good contact information in there. I saw Pastor Diane Owens dropped hers in there as well, especially if you need help with artificial intelligence and if you need help with technology and computers. Pastor Diane Owens is a really great person to speak with. Okay, all right, let's get y'all out of here. Please click that YouTube link so you can go in and watch part one if you need to catch up, because once I exit out, everything disappears. Bye-bye, my loves. Have a beautiful day, and God bless you. Blessings on blessings on blessings on blessings. Thank you, Christine. I always look forward to spending my Tuesdays with you guys, too. Thank you so much, Christine. I'm glad you enjoyed it, Terry. Hope to see you again on Tuesday. Bye, Stevie. Yes, blessings, Taylor. Blessings.